he probably brewed the same beer essentially about 7 or 8 times.
Yeah.
And like the final recipe that we went bought for wasn't too dissimilar to one of the original ones, but little sort of refinements that were made to get it to exactly where we were. And I guess it's one thing I can only sort of empathize with it being in Tim's position, that how nervous at times you would have been getting feedback from people.
Yeah.
The awesome thing about Timmy, he's got absolutely zero ego and yep. just wanted to always make the best product and be able to be confident, you know, in himself that, you know, we've got the product right. I think back to, obviously you weren't able to be there because you're still in the bubble, but we had our first tasting night when we were confident
yep.
that we got the recipe to where we needed to. We had about 13 of the boys. I wouldn't have been that many, obviously, because of restrictions. But we had a few of the boys around to Tim's place and we were hosting like a blind tasting.
Yep.
And there was about 6 different beers that we had and all similar style beers to ours, like a tropical style pale ale XBA type beers. And we were really nervous to put our beer up against those other
well-established
beers yep. and how it would rank. So essentially you'd be trying the beer, writing down what you do or don't like about it, and then of the 6 that you tried, you know, where that would rank. And yep. you wouldn't know at all what beer that you were drinking. So Tim's sort of idea on it was that if we don't come like dead last, that means like we've done all right. So, but still gives you the opportunity to get feedback and improve on it. But we actually came in 2nd overall by 1 point. The beer that beat us was Filters XPA, which is an incredible beer that's only recently set up there,
yep.
big brew house in Sydney. And we were lucky enough to have the company of one of the head brewers from Malt Shovel there on the day, and he actually voted our beer was the best on the night.
Yeah, I remember hearing that.
Oh, Timmy was so gassed up by yeah. it, and we just finally knew then we've got a beer that people are potentially going to really enjoy and want to continue to purchase or consume. So
from there, it essentially went from Tim's brew in his backyard, and if you're watching on YouTube, I'm holding up these cans, and I've actually dated them because one day I'm going to put them in our brewery and just we can be looked back. And this is the first ever one. It's on the 6th of March,
wow,
2020, and that is the 10th of April. And they're obviously empty now, but they're the first samples that we were obviously absolutely frothing on.
They'll be on the Cronulla BK Museum.
But so once we nailed the recipe, boom, we've got the recipe, it's done. Now it's time to scale. So we go from like, you know, Timmy's garage to brewing what? How?
So you're brewing 20 or 40 litres at a time, and then you step up, like if you're going commercial, your minimum would be like 500 litres or something like that, which is a drastic step from, you know, brewing in your garage.
Yep.
But if you're going to produce on enough scale to actually get it out there and get some traction, you know, yep. our first commercial brew was 6,000 litres. So
we went from 20 litres in Tim's garage
to 60,000 litres.
To 6,000 litres in a brewery.
Yeah, and to put that into perspective, like brewing 20 litres at a time that's less than half a normal keg. And our first commercial batch of beer, it was 54 kegs in 212 cases. Like it was
it's a big lot,
you know.